10-year-old and young recipients. And this last talk in the workshop, sticking around, was done by this job of introducing the topic. And you can see the tremendous results that the team has achieved in innovating new development. To put us into context, Dallas is very much an academic program. And we're about 5 years into ours. Fortunately, we just received another 5 years of funding from the NYU Langone Health. So it'll be very interesting to see how the next 5 years go. Probably the title of this talk says inline, MRI-linac, and I'll explain what it is. The mandate that we were given was to make the system flexible so that we could do both inline and perpendicular work. And I'll show you what I mean by that. Firstly, let me acknowledge the team involved. Where's Wally here? This is Paul, not Wally. Paul Keel runs the radiation physics side of the program, and he's used to run the radiation physics lab at Stanford, if you don't know him. Michael Barson is a radiation oncologist in the clinical team, and Gary Liney leads the operation on the day-to-day. He's a medical physicist. So my team is the engineering team, and we got together, and as I said, our mandate was to design the system, so I'm going to focus a bit on the engineering aspects of the system, the magnet, the gradient, and the RF, and finish a little bit by talking about the horizon stuff. So, as Rob showed you very well, the whole thing we're trying to solve here is motion and spare healthy tissue and give maximum dose to tumors. And it's quite surprising once you start looking at dynamic images just how much motion there is, and I'm sure this audience appreciates that. Because the time lapse around the prostate is incredible in how much motion comes on. So, as Rob also said, there are four systems around the world. Taking various different approaches, different field strengths. Some are just perpendicular or in line. Ours is meant to investigate both. What do I mean by that? So this we call perpendicular orientation, where radiation means perpendicular to the beamed field. And we also have a split ball magnet, and ours has a very large split ball, such that we're able to put a patient perpendicularly to beamed. And have the radiation beam in the inline configuration, so parallel to the beam. In addition to having an advantage of having this very large gap in the magnet, is that patients can both stand and sit in the magnet, and we're looking at the possibility of treating patients in a seated position. So, a little bit about our timeline. So, we began around 2013 with a philanthropic grant from the England Institute. A radiation bunker in Cage. My team designed the magnet, the gradient, and the RF coil during that period. And we had the magnet built in Hatchelon factory in the UK, which caused us a fair bit of grief, given that about halfway through the build, they announced they were going to shut the factory down. But fortunately, we were the last magnet out of that factory, called shut down, and it's still running. Thank goodness. Any trouble. So we designed the magnet, the electromagnetics of the magnet, and worked with the engineers at Agilent and Cryogenics to develop the first prototype that they called Alpha Magnet. We got the whole system running using a very heavily modified Siemens console in March, and we now have image guided therapy and started being on work going on Samsung's and just this year. So, a little bit about the magnet. So, it's a very large 50 centimeter free ball cap with an 82 centimeter room temperature ball longitudinally. Your cryogenic heads, of course. And one of the novel things that we designed into this magnet is a lot of it being used in an MRI-linac is a very low field region. So, we adjusted the coil design such that it has a very low field region quite close to the magnet. There's been evidence of the low field nature very close to the end of the magnet so that we can get the linear accelerator as close as possible. Gradients are pretty challenging when you have a 50 centimeter gap. I know clinicians tell us that they wanted to maintain accessibility in that gap as much as possible, and that was the main criteria. So we had a bit of a design challenge in our group. what qualified us to come up with. We have our own very deep design method, based on a boundary element design method, which is a very flexible, free-form design. And conventional designs, you see here, we tried actually the best performing design was this system here that had a big bevel on the spaces of the split of the ball. But it took space about 5 to 6 centimeters away from the free space in the ball, so the clinicians will be able now. And we ended up with a folded three-dimensional design. So the conventional gradients are built in multi-layers and they're interconnected separately. But in these designs, we actually have the primary and the shield folded together in a uniform design with fine conductors. So this is the final split gradient design here. And in two modules, it was built in the UK as well. It's not very good at building these things to our design. Modifications to the Siemens electronics to go from 1.5T down to 1 Tesla in our system. And as you can see, the final gradients in the mainland here completely save three box space. Because we're looking at tracking tumors, then the deformation of the gradients, the linearity of the gradients is very important for us. And we try to maintain as much linearity as possible. So, as little as possible in post-processing correction is needed so that we can ensure spatial accuracy. RF coil design. So we spent a lot of time looking at how we can do things with coils very efficiently in such a large split ball design, and we came up with this sort of design in which essentially we take a quadrature coil, we take the field off it, and we reflect the shield onto the faces of the magnet with active elements dispersing between the two sides of the magnet. And the shield design here is very carefully made to reduce any currents from the gradient. And it turns out the efficiency of this design, even with a 50 centimeter gap, is very close to the efficiency of the 1.5 Tesla 2D whole body design that we measured. So that was quite a success. A couple of early images. So this is a patient lying perpendicular in the gap. First images and comparison with we have a 3D system nearby. We ran some images, obviously, at 1 Tesla, the images are not as good or as well resolved. Lowest signal to lowest than at 3D. But these images are very good, showing the homogeneity of the magnet, linearity of the gradients, the homogeneity of the transmit coil. These images have taken multi-slice in less than 2 minutes. Standing and spinning. So we think this could be quite a good application of this form of system. Here is one of our guys standing and spinning in the magnet. Here we see some images of the lumbar spine. Because we're imaging at resonance speed, hardly any distortions, very good delineation of 1T, good contrast in the lumbar spine. So, getting static images is only a very small part of the story. Of course, we have to have dynamic images, and our targets similarly to the elector system is to have a frame rate of at least 5 frames a second, so that when a patient is free breathing, we can track it in a reasonable time. And here's our most recent work on both phantoms and animal studies, showing radio sample images tracking spheres moving at half frames with a small six-channel parallel radio transparent coil that we've developed in the meantime. So we saw this with and without being on, and measured the dose beam on and beam off, and low difficulty speed. This is the multi-length collimators. So this is how the radiation moves, sprinkles from tracks. And we had a spherical phantom moving across the wall of the magma. We radiated that, and we had detectors surrounding it in the magma, so we could see what sort of radiation dose the sphere of doing safety tests, quality assurance, and so far to craft all of the tests that we need to. We applied for PhD, which is our equivalent of FDA approval, and ethics approval. We're planning to do patient treatment early next year. So, given the nature of this workshop, I thought in the last couple of weeks, I'm on the horizon to make an application for the system like this might be able to achieve. So, a couple more slides and we're done to hang in that place. It was guided proton therapy, could that be possible? So, proton therapy, yeah, it's starting to proliferate very well, even as expensive as they are. So, in 2016, you know, we're approaching about 200 units. There's rapid growth. We've got a couple of systems coming into Australia. And you definitely need the inline configuration to do that sort of work on a split ball system. And so we've done the modeling to have a look at Brandalba in particular, and how proton beams would be affected in the magnetic field and whether proton therapy would be possible. We've concluded that theoretically, yes, it will be possible to do with proton therapy. And one of the great advantages is that these systems are so incredibly expensive that adding them up to it is really nothing. And that's a place you don't hear very often. So, you know, it's dear money, really. So we think this is one of the potential future applications for MRI-linac type systems to be proton therapy. And finally, something else that many of you may be familiar with is a very common cardiac arrhythmia called atrial fibrillation that has a very large pathological patient base. And this causes potential strokes and blood flow. Problems triggered by drugs, but also commonly triggered by ablation, both cryo and RF. And in that system, a catheter is placed to the femoral artery or veins up to the left side of the heart, the right side of the heart, sorry, the central pump track to the left side of the heart, with the goal of ablating the osteo where the pulmonary veins go into the left atrium. And by that, the conduction block is required around the circumference of the orthol osteo to prevent electrical conduction from the pulmonary veins. There are a few of these procedures that can take up to 3 or 4 hours, which is quite long for external fluoroscopy. So the question is, not just coming from us, but a number of people, could we use image-guided radiation therapy to try and ablate some of these arrhythmias? So we've had a PhD student working on this collaboration with the group in Germany. And this is essentially what is going to be required. We are going to have to hit this target here and ablate it with a very focused radiation beam. Surrounding it, of course, with the spinal cord, the aorta, and importantly, the esophagus. So it's not without its challenges. We've developed where we are today. There's a bunch of modeling on this with some preliminary dose banks completed. Animal studies have planned, and some animal studies have already been completed in Germany with quite good success. So, one of the over the horizon possibilities for image-guided radiation therapy is this cardiac work of this nature. So, to conclude, a prototype, one Tesla in line, MRI-linac is still developed, and we plan also to do the parallel implementation as well, perpendicular, sorry. First images. I've spoken a bit about magnet gradient and RF design. Possible future applications.